Lord shine his face upon you.
Yes.
The Lord enlarge your coasts. The Lord surprise you.
Yes.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
I want to take this opportunity to again, once again, thank a few people here. I want to thank Apostle Lorenzo because he was, I think, in the setup of his ministry in Peoria, where I've come to minister, that I met Pastor Mike and his wife Rachel. Mm-hmm. And I still remember that time.
Yes.
Very well. I was in the middle of preaching. Mm-hmm. And I stopped and I said, I'm inviting you as a guest speaker.
Right.
And I was speaking to Pastor Mike Forbes in the coming conference. It was actually like an instruction I gave. And I continued preaching.
Right.
And it came to pass.
Amen.
And I thank you for your obedience and honoring us with your presence in South Africa, Pretoria, together with your wife. And as I said earlier, I don't regret inviting you. You are a blessing to us. And you continue to even be a blessing to us.
Amen.
The next time I visit here, I will not visit alone. I will also visit with my wife.
Amen.
So that she can also tell me the same thing I'm telling you. Maybe I'm not saying it in the best language possible. If she says it, you will know it is true. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So I want to also appreciate Lorenzo's mom, who is here with us.
Amen.
When I went, as I mentioned, for her birthday, I really, really was blessed. The honor she has for servants of God and the testimony of a prayerful life, raising seven children when the husband died, through a heart attack at a tender age, never got married, decided to focus to give her life to her children.
Yes.
That is cool. That is splendid.
Amen.
You know, raising these men the way you did,
yes.
The Lord will continue to bless you.
Amen.
Thank you very, very much. And to just appreciate all of you for this morning receiving the word of the Lord very well. I could see that you received it very well and you're also ready to receive it tonight. Is that so?
Yes.
If you're ready to receive the word of the Lord, lift up both hands like you're crazy. In fact, stand and lift them and behave like an African. Be a little bit, don't be American. Just shout hallelujah. A prophetic night, to be a night of blessing for all of us, and I just want to bring the word of the Lord to us tonight. And I've been looking at a number of scriptures, three in particular that are going to be principal scriptures for the night. And one of those scriptures that I've been looking at that was wonderful to me is in the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27, and I'll be reading from verse 51 to 54. And I will also take interest on the book of Leviticus. I'll also look at the book of Leviticus, and I have what has happened to my notes now. I've been looking at the book of Leviticus. Give me 1 minute. I've lost my notes here, but it's not a problem. If they are gone, I will preach. What have I done to my notes? Can you imagine? They have disappeared just like that. Amazing. What did I press? All right. Not to worry. Matthew 27. I think I've got to find it. Oh, yes! I'll be taking interest in Leviticus chapter 4, verse 17, and 2 Corinthians 3, 13 to 18. Those are going to be my focus tonight. So let me read quickly before I tell you the title of my message, which I know you are waiting for. Matthew 27, 51 to 54. Then, behold, the veil of the temple was torn into two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised, and coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Wow. So when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that happened, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. I will be speaking tonight about breaking through the veil.
Breaking through the veil.
Breaking through the veil. And in case you forget that title of the message, I will also be bringing a subtitle, which is Veil Breakers. Veil Breakers. So breaking through the veils. The other title of the message is Veil Breakers. And I'm tempted to give you a third title, but I think if I give you the third one, you might say, what kind of African is this one? But let me just do it, because I know you give two titles. I'll give a third one and make it different, because I know main title, subtitle is allowed, but I don't see people doing three of them. So I'll do the third one, and I will call it Breaking Through the Cherubim. Breaking Through the Cherubim. Now, the passage of scripture we have read in the book of Matthew is the account of when Jesus Christ was crucified. When Jesus Christ was crucified, some extraordinary things happened. Extraordinary things happened when Jesus Christ got crucified. And one of those extraordinary things that happened was the veil in the temple getting torn from the top to the bottom. That was an extraordinary something that happened. I took interest to study about that veil. And I read that that veil was as thick as the hand of a man. Whether it is true or not, I don't know. But I read, I think there are historians like Josephus and others who have explained that that veil was very, very thick.
Yeah.
And there is also some explanation that it was also wide, 50 feet.
Yeah.
And 50 feet wide, and the height of it was 60 feet.
Yeah.
Very, very high. So it was also not something that was, it was thick, it was wide, it was tall. So you can imagine when Jesus Christ was crucified, one of the things that happened was the veil getting torn from the top to the bottom. Not from the bottom to the top, from the top to the bottom. Whoa! That one was amazing. Let me explain what the veil was there for, just quickly, so that you understand the significance of the tearing of the veil. Of the tearing of the veil, because you might sit there and say, but what is that to us? When God wanted to draw closer to man, after the man fell from sin, he decided to introduce a house for fellowship. You know, God is a God of family. And he said, I will give Moses a pattern to build a house. And that house is called the Old Tabernacle.
Yes.
It is a house of meeting. And God said, this is going to be my place of connecting with man.
Yes.
Because man had fallen short of the glory of God.
Yeah.
And in the courtyard, everybody will be allowed. It will be the lounge where every Tom, Dick, and Harry can come.
Yes.
But there will be a second place, which is called the holy place. And in that holy place, only the priests and those consecrated will come to that place.
Yes, yes.
And then there will be a third place, which is called the Holy of Holies. And in the Holy of Holies, only one man will be allowed there. Mm. And that will be the high priest. And God spoke to Moses. He said, in that house, which is called the Old Tabernacle, where there are many people, there will be two altars. Mm. Where there are priests, there will be three altars. And where there is the one man, there will be many altars. Mm. And then so God said, and in the Holy of Holies, because I know these people are naughty, they like taking a peep and looking at places they should not look.
Come on, that's good, that's good.
I know Americans do that as well. We need to put a veil to some Americans. They like sneaking around and looking at things they should not look at. Mm. Ah, okay, not Americans, Africans. Let me talk about Africans in case you are here. So God said, between the holy place and the Holy of Holies, I will protect the things inside there. Because those things in the Holy of Holies, they are not for the eyes of everybody. There is going to be a box in the Holy of Holies called the Ark of the Covenant.
Yes.
And in the Ark of the Covenant, there will be a pot of manna. You know, manna was supernaturally received.
Yes.
There will be Aaron's rod, and there will be a table of 10 commandments, and there will be cherubims and the mercy seat.
Yeah.
Oh, that is not a place I want the masses to see. Not even ordinary priests to see. Only the high priest should see. Mm. And even he himself, if he's not clean enough,
right,
if he decides to go and take a peep there, he will die. So he better follow some processes and protocols that will ensure that he breaks through the veil in the correct manner in order for him to enjoy that place where we are told,
ooh,
I love that place called the Holy of Holies.
Yes.
And you know, it was told, you know, that place called the Holy of Holies, there is no need for lights.
Right.
Because the glory of the Lord shines in that place. The Shekinah glory shines in that place. It is a place of the fullness of God. It is a place rich with the presence of God. Because I, God, sit on the mercy seat between the cherubim.
Yes.
And therefore God said, before you come to the Holy of Holies, there will be a veil. And before the veil, there will be an altar, which is called the altar of incense. On the altar of incense, you will only use red hot coals that don't have any smoke. Ha! Don't come there with firewood like Africans to burn incense. Burn your fire in the courtyard. And when the coals are red hot, then you as a high priest, you take those red hot coals and you come to the altar of incense with red hot coals and you burn incense. And when the incense is burnt, that smell will either cause me to stand from my seat, the mercy seat, and to inhabit your worship. I'm now telling you what the incense was. Or I will decide to sit and tell you, do not come in. Mm. Hallelujah. Yeah. Glory, glory, glory. Are you still with me, by the way? So between the veil and the Holy of Holies, there was an altar which was very important, which is the altar of incense. jail breakers. And I will come back to the story of Jesus quickly. Now, in the morning is when he discovered, oh, this is now the wrong woman. But let me explain something else about breaking the veil, which is also a little bit intimate, because it is part of the message. In every woman, there is a veil, especially down there. Especially in the olden times, it was expected that a woman would be married when she was a virgin.
Yes.
And so when she's a virgin, there is something they call the hymen, which the man needed to penetrate and break through the husband.
Yeah.
If the husband came and penetrated and he thought there was no veil, he would have said, who entered the Holy of Holies before me? Are you getting the point?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll leave that because that is another story. I'm explaining different kinds of faith. But you know the whole issue of worship is very important. Because for that veil even of a woman to be broken, you cannot come to the woman and just tell her, let's do it. You must tell her, I love you to the moon and blood. You must do some worship. You must do some worship. Otherwise, you will have difficulties penetrating the veil. Some other stuff here. So worship is very critical as a veil breaker.
Yes.
The blood of Jesus is very critical as a veil breaker. We cannot approach the throne of grace without the sprinkling of the blood.
Yes.
And without worship and intercession.
Yes.
The correct worship and the correct intercession is needed in order for us to break through the veil. Now, if you read the book of Corinthians, the one I mentioned quickly, you will discover that Paul discusses to the Corinthians about their minds being blinded. And then he also says about their hearts being blinded. Whoa! So meaning that the veil can also be a veil in your mind.
Yes,
yes. It can also be a veil in your hearts. So there are all manner of veils. When you have a veil, like Paul discusses in the passage of scripture I mentioned, in your heart, then you don't see things correctly.
Right.
Because they say that when they read Moses, the veil is still upon them. And therefore they don't see Christ in the five books, in the Pentateuch. They're waiting for Jesus. The Messiah has come.
Yes.
And yet they are still waiting for him and he has shown up. Oh my goodness, somebody's veil is not to be removed.
Hallelujah.
And if these Jewish people are like me, when I was looking for a wife, I was teaching this group of women, professional women in the city of Nairobi Bible study. A young single pastor. I was not as fat as I am. This is my wife to blame. I was slender. And I was teaching this group of women. And I was looking for a wife outside that group. I had a baby. I could not see that my wife was just below my nose. I had to go, I don't know how many kilometers. For a bishop to tell me, the woman is already there. Now which one? And then I said, oh, the one. Because the veil I had was a cultural veil. Because my wife was a single mother. So the issue with me, growing up in a pastor's home, was that I must marry a lady who is not a single mother. So that became a veil. And yet this single mother was full of the Spirit. Full of anointing, and I could not see her because of cultural veils. There are even veils which can block even Americans.
Yes.
For them not to see God, instead of seeing me as a man of God, for example, they can say this Kenyan, they are seeing an African man instead of seeing Jesus. Or seeing Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Messiah, came.
Yes.
He came. And he's coming a second time, but he already came.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I was reading an interesting scripture of the disciples walking after Jesus was crucified on the road to Emmaus.
Right, right.
They are walking with him, and they don't recognize him. Oh, I don't know whether you have ever read that account.
Yes.
In Luke chapter 24, you read where Jesus Christ, after he rose from the dead, he appeared to some women.
Yeah.
And he said, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? I have risen up from the grave. And you're looking for me in the wrong place." There are people who are looking for Jesus in the grave.
Mm.
He is alive.
Wow.
He has risen from the grave.
Yeah.
He's not only in the tomb. He's not even on the cross, like some people put Jesus on the cross forever. He's not over there.
Amen.
He's not over there. You're looking for him in the wrong places.
Amen.
And these disciples, after Jesus rose from the dead, they were walking to them on the road to Emmaus. Very sad.
Yes.
Discussing the events that had taken place.
Yes.
And they were saying, a great prophet. Oh, a great prophet?
Yes.
Is he a great prophet indeed? He's not a prophet. He's the Son of God. He's a fourth man. They were discussing the events. And they had company. They had company. And you know who came to join them on that journey? Jesus Christ himself. Jesus Christ himself. And they discussed. And they continued to walk. And Jesus Christ began to reveal scripture of what he had said about his crucifixion and resurrection.
Amen.
And they continued to walk together. And these guys were blind, not physically. They were seeing where they were going, but they could not recognize Jesus.
Yeah.
Until something interesting happened.
Right.
When they reached him out, Jesus Christ took wine. And he took bread. And he broke it. This is a veil breaker.
Hallelujah.
This is a veil breaker.
Hallelujah.
This is a veil breaker. This is a veil breaker.
Hallelujah.
Because these guys could not see. Until he took the bread. He broke it. And he said, "Take it. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do it in remembrance of me." Then he says, "Then drink. This is my blood, which is the blood of the covenant, which has been shed for you." And as Jesus says, "Take it," suddenly their eyes open. We have been walking with him. We have been giving him long stories. And yet we could not see him. We did not see him.
Yeah.
Tonight, I want to declare and I want to prophesy that the eyes of the people in this house, they shall be open.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
You shall see him as you ought to see him.
My God, yes.
Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God.
Amen.
Your eyes will pop open.
Yes.
You will be able to see him as you ought to see him.
Yes.
You know, you will not just be coming to church and just worship and go. Oh my goodness. I pray that your eyes, the eyes of your understanding, Ephesians chapter 1 verse 17, that the eyes of your understanding will be opened. earth.
Yes, yes, yes.
Our God. Sometimes our God, he hides himself.
Yes.
Yes.
And if you are not careful, you will not see him. You must seek him.
Yes.
And when you seek him, then he says, here I am. But if you don't seek him, it will be hide and seek. You look for him. Are you here, God?
Yeah.
And God is saying, he's looking at you from the sides. But when you seek him and worship him the way he wants,
come on. Yes.
Here I am. Fasting is a powerful way of breaking through That God will give you a veil break. provision, a whole bakery of bread and drink, a whole tank of Holy Communion and go to hell. Because you are not born again. Yes. You don't know the main breaker.
Yes.
I'll tell you something quickly. And I'm rushing. I want to preach, finish, and pray for you. I'm bringing back Africa to America.
Amen.
You brought the gospel to us, but you must wake up. You're sleeping too much, you Americans.
Amen.
Yeah, America must arise.
Yes. Yes.
It must come back to the origin. I think you have lost it. You have left home. You've gone to a far country. Yeah? America. In God we trust. Are you still trusting him or you're not trusting dollar or what? I might be stoned. You are already in prison. Hey, America, forgive me. I still need to go back to Africa, so let me not be too strong on that one. Now, what I'm saying to you, you need a veil breaker.
Yeah.
Let me give you another veil breaker in the scriptures. Naomi. Naomi has come with Ruth. She has come back. She left with her husband and two boys in the book of Ruth. And when she left, when she went to, she moved from, I think, Bethlehem. You know, the decision of moving from the house of bread to Moab is a wrong decision.
Yeah.
Don't move from Moab. Don't move from Bethlehem, the house of bread, to Moab, the place of incense and homosexuality. Don't move there! So they have moved. And when Naomi and her husband and her two sons moved, made the wrong move, death happened. But what happened? The daughter-in-law, he said to them, now you guys go look for other husbands. Because my two sons are dead. Get, because they were young ladies. And one lady called Ruth. The other one left said, okay, I think it's a good idea. But one of them called Ruth, in Ruth chapter 1, verse 16, she says to Naomi, oh my goodness, I have found my veil breaker. Yeah, your mother-in-law, I don't know whether Americans have jokes on mother-in-laws. They are not very popular in Africa, but maybe here they are very popular. Your mother-in-law can be your veil breaker.
Yes.
I've said the wrong word. I know you wanted to say she's a demon. She can be a very great. Now I'm telling you what happened. Naomi, Ruth said to Naomi in Ruth 1:16, you are God who will be my God.
Yeah,
your people will be my people. Yeah. Where you lodge, I will lodge.
Yes.
It's only death that will part us. You know, when you find a veil breaker, you won't cling to them. Cling to them.
Yeah.
Eh?
Yeah.
A man shall leave his father and mother. My wife is not here, so I'll use my son. A man will leave his father and mother and cling to his wife. What? What happened to Ruth and Naomi is that Ruth clung to her veil breaker, Naomi. And when they reached Bethlehem, thank you, sir. Hey, Naomi started to scratch her head. She said, when I left Bethlehem, Boaz was single. Come back, he's still single, but he has money, he has farms. Hey, I'm going to connect faith to wealth. I'm going to connect faith to wealth. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You know, Naomi was able to look at Boaz, you know, something is missing. Because the scriptures are clear, it is not good for man to be alone. And this is what the Bible says. Naomi said, you must dress up, smell up, and do all manner of apps. You don't just break through the veil with your gumboots. If you want to break through the veil, you must style up, dress up, pray up, anoint up, do up whatever you can do up. Glory! Are you listening?
Yes.
And this is what Ruth did. She went and she lifted the cover that was on the feet of Boaz. And Boaz was sleeping. But when he turned in the night, because he was sleeping on a threshing floor, it's a hard place. He was sleeping on a hard floor. When he turned, his feet touched something softer than a pillow. He woke up and says, I don't think I came with a pillow here. He looked and says, it's a woman. Ruth. And she says to me, ha, please extend your cover towards me. And she had been instructed. And that's the end of the story. How the veil was broken. Glory be to God. So they are veil breakers. People like prophets are veil breakers. They bring revelation, they bring knowledge, they bring the word of God, and they open your eyes so that you can break through the veil. They present the menu to you. Like Elijah said, tomorrow this time, food, flour will be costing one shekel. He spoke the word prophetically.
Yes.
In order to break the veil or the siege that was upon Samaria. Now, when we talk about territories, areas, nations, some places have a veil that has covered the place that prevents the people of that place to break through. I want to prophesy to Pekin. Is it Pekin or Pekin or
Pekin?
Whatever veil is upon this city must be broken by the river of God.
Hallelujah.
So that the city can have open heavens. I want to declare Pekin will be better. Like that place where Jacob went. The Bible says when Jacob went to that place and he slept on the way, that the heavens opened.
Yeah.
He saw angels descending and angels ascending. It was a place where there was no veil. And when he woke up, he said, this must be the gateway of heaven.
Yeah.
Because there was no veil. He was able to penetrate direct to the heavens.
Yeah.
So if there is a prince and principalities and powers of darkness that have covered territories and covered the minds of Americans, we must pray as a church for the veil to be broken in the nation.
Yes, hallelujah.
So that America sees God and Christ as they ought to see him.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
I think I've preached too much.
No, you don't.
You're fine.
I'm thinking that I've... You know, you might say, he preached for 3 hours. Pastor, don't invite him. Veil breakers. Breaking through the veil. Let me mention the issue of cherubim as I finish. The veil in the tabernacle had a print. It was embroidered a cherubim. So breaking through the veil is breaking through the cherubim. The cherubims and the seraphims is the heavenly intelligence and protection, the bodyguards of God. Those creatures have wings, they have all manner of things. You try and come before God without proper protocol. Just one feather slaps you, bam, you're dead. Cherubims, seraphims, cherubims and seraphims, gatekeepers of the heavens. So they look at whether you have followed protocol. Do you have the mark of the blood? If you have the mark of the blood, the cherubims allow you to break through the veil. Glory be to God. Blessed be the name of Jesus. So tonight, we will partake of the Lord's body. Before I pray for anyone, you will partake of his body and his blood, not religiously, with revelation. Tonight, you are praying, as I partake of this, like those disciples on the road of Emmaus, may my eyes open. May I see in the realm of the Spirit. If there is any sin in my life, Father, cleanse me through the shed blood of Jesus.
Yes,
Lord. That blood, may it be sprinkled upon your conscience, upon your mind, upon your hearts, so that you will be acceptable before God tonight. Yes. And so that your life will become like the life of Apostle Paul, who met Jesus on the road wherever he was going to Damascus. And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" He could not see him. His eyes were blind. Paul was blind. And it took a veil breaker called Ananias to pray for him.
Yes.
For him to see. So may God send Ananias your way. May the Lord send veil breakers. For example, you know, sometimes in Africa, a woman can be so beautiful, full house, but not being married. Because spiritually there is a veil upon her. So men don't see her. Can you imagine a very beautiful lady staying single 35, 39 years? The brothers, they come, they pass her, they go and propose to another one and they leave her. Because there is a veil, spiritual veil. Tonight, whatever veil is hindering you to be visible, your potential to be covered. You can imagine having giftings. You are very gifted. But nobody sees it. Nobody sees it. You go for a job interview, they don't even see what you are talking about. That will not be your portion. So after partaking of the meal tonight, God is going to remove any spiritual, social, psychological veil and make you visible.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
And God will also make himself visible to you. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
So don't eat this. This can kill you. This is also a bit poison. If you take it and you are a criminal, you don't repent of your sin, you take it religiously, it can bring weakness, sickness, and death. 1 Corinthians 11:23-30. So before taking this, particularly this one of tonight, repent of all your sin. If you are a habitual sinner, don't even tell the pastor. You go to the corner there and say, you know, I did this, I did that. The Lord forgive you. Okay?
Amen.
It is you and God. Amen.
Amen.
Then you drink of it. Amen.
Amen.
And when you partake of it, what's going to happen tonight is that you will begin to prosper. Yeah? You will begin to see things. Huh? Thank you, thank you, thank you. Yeah, we have some very good people here, you know. Yeah? Hallelujah! Yeah. When you partake of this, your eyes will open. Yeah? Your eyes will open. But you must repent. Don't partake of it without saying, "Lord, I'm a sinner." If you're not born again, you come and pray with me. Say, "Lord, I want to receive you as a personal Savior." Please, don't take this one. If you're not born again, you come and whisper, you say, "You know me, I'm lost. Please pray for me to be born again." You have raised the likes of Billy Graham. You should not forget, evangelism, he has told you these things. Yeah, I'm just coming to emphasize, there's a man from Africa. I hope you understood my English. Guys, my English is African. Did you understand? Was it clear? Was it fine?
No?
Hallelujah.
Amen.
in Tamar. All right. Just as in that bread. Yeah. Just find out whether yours has bread. Hallelujah. Tonight is tonight. Let me come. Tonight is your night. Your veil will be broken. God will introduce you to veil breakers. In Jesus' mighty name. Take time and pray by yourself. I don't need to tell you how to pray. Others are ready to pray for him. Take time and pray.